Hello everyone, welcome to video lecture series of Computer Organization and Architecture. Today's topic is Modes of Transfer. In this video, I'll be telling you about the different possible modes via which data transfer to and from peripherals can be done. Let us begin. First, as you are aware that machines or the computer system that deals with the binary information, and the binary information which is received from any external device that is stored in the memory itself, right? So means each and every information which is to be transferred from any of the external device that is going to be stored in the memory in the form of the binary means the information that is transferred from the CPU to the external device that is originated from the memory unit means CPU merely transfer the CPU processes the information, but actually the source and target is always the memory unit means memory unit is the source and target. So what happened? Data transfer between CPU and IO devices, right? That may be done in different modes. So because in some of the modes, data transfer between CPU and IO that can be done where the CPU is the intermediate path. While in some of the cases, data transfer can be done directly in between the memory and the IO devices, right? So there are different possible ways via which data transfer can be done. Three of them I've listed out over there: programmed IO, interrupt initiated IO, and direct memory access. Now let us talk about each one of them in detail. First is the programmed IO. Programmed IO, this is one of the simplest form of the input-output. And here in this particular thing, CPU has to perform all the tasks. CPU has to perform everything. Every work is to be done by the CPU. Means this particular technique, which is the simplest technique or approach, you can say, here data transfer between the processor and the IO module is being done. Means transfer is via CPU only. So what happened in this particular case, in the case of programmed IO, it is because the IO instructions, those instructions are written in the computer program, right? And when program is being executed means each and every instruction is being executed. It means each data item that transfer that is initiated by an instruction which is written in that particular program. So usually the transfer is from CPU register and memory, right? In general cases. So in the case of programmed IO, it requires constant monitoring by the CPU. Constant monitoring by the CPU for whom? For peripheral devices. Means CPU continuously monitor the peripheral device, whether the peripheral devices are ready for data transfer or not. Since CPU is continuously monitoring the peripheral devices, means it is continuously busy for monitoring, right? And in that particular time, CPU may not be able to do something because there is just only the monitoring thing. So that is why it is very time consuming. CPU is unnecessarily busy in monitoring the things, right? So that is what the programmed IO. There are some advantages. Programmed IO is simple to implement and very small hardware is being required. But there are certain disadvantages. Busy waiting, as I have told you that CPU continuously monitors the peripherals, whether the data, whether those particular peripherals are ready for data transfer or not. And it ties up CPU for longer period with no use of work, as if they are just doing the monitoring. Second type of data transfer technique, that is interrupt initiated IO. As from the name itself, interrupt means there is some of the task is being stopped, means interrupted, then other is being handled and again it is going to be resumed for the original work. That is what the interrupt initiated. So the beauty of this interrupt initiated is, as you have seen the disadvantage or the limitation of programmed IO, CPU is continuously busy in monitoring the peripherals, whether they are ready to transfer the data or not. That particular limitation is overcome in this particular case. Here, CPU is not continuously busy, means it has to be, there is a certain mechanism via which it can be done. And that is what, that is nothing but it uses the concept of interrupt. So by using interrupt facility, some special commands have been sent, and these commands is actually being sent to the interface so that those particular interface may issue a interrupt request signal. And why there is a requirement of interrupt request signal? Because when the data is available from any device, then that particular interrupt request signal is being issued, and in the meantime, CPU can proceed for the other execution. So the interface monitors continuously the device, right? That is what the interrupt initiated. So what happens when interrupt signal that is being issued, interrupt request signal that is being issued, and that will be issued only when the device is ready. It means device is ready to for data transfer and the signal is already initiated. Then CPU, when observe the signal, then CPU will stop the task which it was executing currently, and then it is going to perform the other request. And after the execution of other request, it will return back to the main task which it was performing earlier and will do the completion. So this is how interrupt initiated IO takes place, right? Means there is no need to continuously monitor the peripherals. Just when the peripherals are ready, then there is a interrupt request signal which is being initiated by the interface. So what happened, as you have observed both the cases, right? Programmed IO and interrupt initiated IO. So in both of the cases, they suffer from two major drawbacks. One is processor is only the thing who is going to manage an IO transfer and the number of instructions which must be executed for each IO. And the second drawback is IO transfer rate that is limited by the speed, right? Speed with which any processor can process the information. So these two drawbacks can be overcome in the third mode, third technique, which is the direct memory access. Direct memory access means here interface transfers the data into and out of the memory through the memory bus. Direct memory access means here data transfer can happen in between the memory and the IO. There is no need to involve the CPU at every time. Means CPU initiates the transfer, and this is done by supplying the interface with the starting address. And then data transfer between any fast storage medium, as if magnetic tape, magnetic disk or memory, that is done by the directly among the memory and the IO. It means DMA allow the peripherals to directly communicate with each other. IO input-output devices can directly communicate with each other via the memory. So this type of data transfer technique, that is known as a DMA or direct memory access, right? So you must remember, when the transfer is made, then DMA request memory cycle through the memory bus. And when request is granted, now there is a role of memory controller, means DMA transfer the data directly into memory. And CPU merely delays its memory access operation so that it is capable to allow to direct memory IO transfer. There is just a delay, right? That is what which is being done. It means during DMA, the CPU is idle and it has no control over the memory bus. Obviously, when the DMA controller is taking the control of the buses, that is why there is a directly transfer of data in between the memory and the IO. So that is why this is very, very advantageous and the preferred one. There are some of the advantages. Advantages, as I've told you, it allows peripheral directly to read and write into the memory without involving CPU, allows faster processing because the processor can be working on something else when there is a transfer of information from the memory and the IO. Certain limitations, there is a requirement of DMA controller. Obviously, here the DMA controller is the thing who is carrying out the operation, and since there is a requirement of DMA controller, so it increases the system cost also. Some problems related to cache coherence may be observed in the case of the DMA. So these are the various advantages and disadvantages. Thank you so much for watching this video.